Calculus is a branch of mathematics that deals with very small changes. Let me explain this with an example. Imagine that you have a unique magnifying lens that can zoom into the tiniest fraction of a millimeter. Now, picture a snail slowly moving along the beach. With the naked eye, you see the snail's movement as smooth and continuous. However, when you look through the magnifying lens, you can see what appears to be smooth motion is actually a combination of many small movements that are not smooth at all. This is a bit like calculus, which consists of two main segments, differential calculus and integral calculus. Differential calculus primarily deals with the rate of change of things, while integral calculus is concerned with the accumulation of smaller quantities and allows us to see the big picture. Just as that special magnifying glass could let us see the tiniest movements of a snail's body, differential calculus allows us to examine tiny, moment-by-moment changes. Think of it this way. When you're in a car, the speedometer shows you how fast you're going at that exact moment. If the speedometer says 50 miles per hour, it means that the car is moving at a rate that will cover a distance of 50 miles in 1 hour. However, it's unlikely that you'll maintain a constant speed for an entire hour. You might speed up or slow down while merging or stopping at traffic signals. After your trip, you can calculate your speed during the entire trip by dividing the total distance traveled by the total time taken. This will give you an overall idea of how fast you were going during your trip, or in other technical terms, it will tell you the average speed of the car. However, if you want to know the speed of a car at a particular instant during the trip, you will need to use differential calculus. It's like watching a race of cars, but you can hit pause any time during the race and know exactly how fast a particular car is going in that particular instant. On the flip side, if you want to find out how much distance a particular car traveled throughout the entire race, you would need integral calculus, because it lets you put together small, moment-to-moment snapshots in order to see the entire picture. In more technical terms, differential calculus deals with the rates of change of things, such as speed and the slope of a curve. On the other hand, integral calculus helps determine the total size of something, such as area and volume. For many years, the widely held belief was that two renowned mathematicians of their time, Isaac Newton and Gottfried Leibniz, discovered calculus in the late 17th century. However, groundbreaking scientific discoveries do not emerge from thin air. For instance, the atomic model underwent several revisions before we achieved our current understanding of the composition of an atom. Even today, we are constantly uncovering new details about how things work inside an atom. Similarly, some of the elements of the calculus we know today were developed by mathematicians from ancient India, Greece, Egypt, and some Middle Eastern countries many years before Newton and Gottfried claimed credit. The controversy surrounding the discovery of calculus was enormous at the time and was often referred to as the Leibniz-Newton calculus controversy, with the question of who discovered calculus first, Leibniz or Newton, being hotly debated. Controversies aside, the contributions of both mathematicians in the development of calculus were unprecedented and immensely useful, as they made calculus an integral part of civilization through its countless applications. The principles of differential and integral calculus are used in medical sciences to diagnose and treat medical conditions. Doctors who research infectious diseases use calculus to discover the spread rate and the area where an infection is likely to occur. The side effects of medicine, brought about by minute external factors, such as interactions with other drugs and changes in body temperature, can be computed using integral calculus. Calculus is also essential for business and economics, as credit card companies use calculus to set payment structures. Policymakers use the supply-demand graph to set economic policies driven by decisions based on mathematical information. Civil engineers, architects, and structural engineers use calculus to make critical decisions about the height of buildings and which materials to use in order to withstand the forces of nature. In mathematics circles, calculus often gets a bad rap for being difficult to understand for students, as many people believe that calculus has a steep learning curve. But at least with calculus, you are able to precisely determine how steep that curve is.